Christ suffered.
Yes, he did.
In order that you might become somebody.
Yeah, yeah.
That's why you ought to rejoice.
Amen.
God bless you now. We should go. Starts reading it again tonight. These brethren have been excellent all day. I told you tonight, this is not a homework assignment, but you need to read, like Paul Harvey said, the rest of the story.
Yeah.
I'm going to, for the sake of bringing those up with us where we are from this morning, when we talked about Brother Zacharias and his wife Elizabeth. And one of the things that I wanted to, that we are made to believe from the story, is that Zacharias, being a priest, and the Bible even say that he and his wife both were blameless before the Lord, that Zacharias had some weaknesses.
Excuse me.
We want to say and share that one of the things that I know that resonates with each of us tonight is that in our text, Zechariah apparently had prayed to God for children. He had prayed on the behalf of his wife to be able to conceive a child. We see that in the text because from out of the clear blue sky, verse 7 says, and they didn't have no children. Because Elizabeth was barren and they both were now well stricken in years. I told you this morning, we've heard that beforehand from the Bible.
Yeah.
Excuse me. And the Bible said, and it came to pass, and this is the part, you got to watch the word again. It says, and it came to pass, during this time, Zechariah, the prayer is being reflected. He's remembering the prayer that he prayed to the Lord for a child. Even though every Lord's Day he went to that temple, I told you this morning, he lit that incense. That was his job. He worked through the cycles, but wasn't taking God at his word.
Yeah, yeah.
And so verse 8 said, and it came to pass. Mm-hmm. In other words, time had expired. He's at the temple. Right. And the Bible says he's executing his priest's office. Or in other words, he's executed his duties in the temple before the Lord. What I tried to relate to us this morning is we have to be careful, church, that we actually come and open ourselves up and worship God in spirit and in truth. This is just not a formula we're going through. This is not just metaphorically doing. We have to give ourselves. We sing the song. We give ourselves. We have to do that.
Yeah.
We have to leave all of the trials and all of our trouble at the door and empty ourselves when we come into the house and worship God. And it just seems like Zechariah was just going through the motions. So in verse 8, it said, it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of the course, according to the customs of that office, his lot was to burn the incense. And when we drop down to 11, it says, and there appeared unto him an angel an angel came to him. And what I want you to see in this, that over the course of time, we have to understand this ourselves. Why are there problems when it comes to our prayers being answered? Why does God settle when I offer or ask prayers? Is God ever silent to me during my prayers? And in prayer, as I said this morning, it's one of those things, prayer. There are many prayers that many of us have uttered in life that still remain unanswered. Amen. And some of those prayers that we have uttered on this journey called life may appear to be burdens now. That's what this thing was with him. He had prayed to God for him and Elizabeth to have a child, maybe when he was in his young age, and now the Bible says, and now they old. They're stricken. In fact, that's what stricken is. Amplified. They got issues now. I understand it, and I'm old and I got issues. Days I walk like I got two left feet. Some days I have to stand before I take off walking. Then he told me he went to the doctor said, now you done got old when you stand up. Now I can stand up a few minutes. You can't just hop right up and take them. So stricken issues are happening now. And Zechariah sees the reality of this, and so he is troubled because his prayer to him has been unanswered. When this angel came, the Bible says when he saw him, he was troubled. He was troubled. He was troubled. And he says, and his fear fell upon him. One of the things that I want you to understand is that we ought to be praying people that's taking God is we ought to learn to pray. And many times when you pray, we must pray in the will of God, not our will. Yeah. Even though it's us, there is, as I said this morning, there is no substitution for prayer. That nothing you can speak so eloquent, nothing can give you more enthusiasm and energy than being able to talk everything with the Lord. Amen. Not everyone has the same privilege. When you find yourself not praying, amen. Sometimes we call ourselves getting mad at God. I ain't gonna pray. When you find yourself not praying, you're not hurting God. You're hurting you. When we pray, we are confessing to God that we have the inability to solve the things that are going on in our life, and we're reaching to his ability to be able to solve it. That's what Zechariah was saying. If he and Elizabeth could have had a child without the help of God, they would have had it. And now it's beyond their ability. Just like them. We are just like them. They thought when they asked, because he was a priest, he was very dutiful in the temple. They both were blameless before God. He thought that when he asked, with all of that, that God would respond when Zechariah wanted him to. The Bible said it came some years later. All of a sudden, out of the clear blue sky, God decided to respond.
Isn't that something?
And so I want to talk to you a few minutes about three things. I've got 10 minutes. If you want to stay, then we'll dismiss and you can stay and get the rest of the stuff. Sometimes our prayers are denied. Let's be honest. They are denied. And God will say no sometimes to our prayers. And many times when God says no, unfortunately, he's saying no not because of him, but because of us. Well, we're not asking maybe in the right spirit, or we're being selfish in what we're asking. So God may say no. Hey, you got your Bibles? I only got a few minutes. Let's run the James. You know these old scriptures. You know. Run the James, chapter 4. You get there, you let me know you're there. Amen.
Amen.
James 4. What do you mean? And let's look. I tell you what. Let's start in verse 1.
That's good. From whence come wars and fighting among
you? James, it's a, from whence come wars and fighting among you?
Come they not
come
hence,
they not
even of your lust,
you lust
that war in your members.
When you have lust, that war in your members. What's what he said?
Ye lust,
you lust
and have
not.
Ye kill,
kill
and desire to have, and cannot
obtain.
Ye fight and war, yet ye have not.
Come,
because ye ask not.
Because you ask not.
Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss.
A lot of the issues that God, the prayer is unanswered, is not God, it's me.
Yeah.
Amen. So when I ask God and God doesn't answer to my expectation, it's my fault. According to the text, amen. He says, you ask and receive not because you ask the fish that you may consume it.
On
in other words, you're asking in the wrong hat with the wrong disposition in hand.
Right.
Attached to that is selfishness. Look at James 3. James 4:3, he said, you ask and receive not because you ask amiss. Is selfishness or pride? He says you don't receive because you ask them. Well, is sin involved in that? You ask that you don't receive. Is prayerlessness involved in that? Is this the first time that you have been driven to the throne of God for prayer? You don't have a real prayer life. You just have a need. So, he said, now, we don't know what happened, but we do know that God heard him. And I want to say, when you pray, because you're still waiting on unanswered prayer. Even, what was it, an Acts 10? Cornelius, who was a non-Christian, who was praying to God, probably living a better life than he wasn't just going through the motions. God had to send someone to him to say that your prayers are coming up as a memorial before me. In other words, God said, I can't respond to yours, Cornelius, because you haven't completed all you need to do. But now, but we don't know. That's not the case. That's not the case with Zacharias. But what we can say, is that Zacharias' prayer was God didn't say no. believe it.
I bring one up here this
age. We'd hate to, but we'd have.
This is a church baby.
We wouldn't be able to deal with that. Poor fellow would have to raise his son. But God responds. Is that right? He didn't tell him no. Delayed his blessing. And many blessings, many prayers that we mutter in private and in public and ask for prayer, God has delayed the answer.
Mercy.
But you have delayed. And when God answers, it will be so. Enough. Because part of God's answer, as we see it in this text, is that God responds conditionally on his promises. Some of God's promises that we stand on and live under every day, some of them are conditional, some of them are unconditional. Some of our prayers are God responds conditionally. But we have to be in God's grace. And in some prayers, God just responds. Yes. We don't know how to accept all the time when God responds, yes. As I said this morning, you may pray for the comet. God may put you, have you moved near a bus line. You don't have a car, but you got transportation. You may pray for a job. Amen. The thing about us, you know, when we pray, we want it specific. First of all, that's selfish. So you're not, I'm telling you tonight, you're not that he's not gonna respond to that. In due time. But he does respond. But however he responds, as I said this morning, you and I are better off for his response. He puts it this way, it's a victory. We have God's grace when he has extended his mercy, and when he is answering our prayers. God has responded. When you go through tonight, I know you will. But read the rest of the story there in Luke. You want to see that not only did was Zacharias and Elizabeth a blessing. They stood forward. They were the door to the blessings that followed in that order. But see, God had to use someone to get them ready for that. He didn't realize, he didn't really know how blessed he really was. Many times we miss out because we don't know. Which we're in the church. We have been obedient, and as long as we fight, Paul says in Galatians, we will reap. We came to be a more stupid Christian. And I say that because all of us, maybe we need to check us, see where we are falling, and be more stupid. Jesus has done his work. Those songs says he paid it all. He came to this old dusty live a sinless life, endure all of the consequences, the hardships, the spitting on, the whipping. Would do it for a wretch like me. You're here tonight. You're not a member of the church. Not a member of the body of Christ. You need to come. Listen, I want to tell you, our lives are not in our lives. You may not feel tonight that you need him, but there will be. You're going to need Jesus. You're going to really need him. I want to tell you this tonight. He doesn't need any of us, but all of us.